Well, hey everybody, we're going to start this chapter about statistics. This video in particular is going to be about sampling techniques. But let's define statistics first. It's the art and science of gathering, analyzing, and making inferences, also known as predictions, from numerical information, which we call data, that we obtain in an experiment. Now, notice that this definition actually splits statistics into two pieces. One part of statistics is about gathering and analyzing data. That part of statistics is called descriptive statistics. The other part of statistics is about making inferences, or predictions based on your data. This part of statistics is called inferential statistics. When we talk about statistics, there's typically a big group of items or people that we're interested in. We call that our population. For example, if a study is interested in looking at rates of heart disease among people 65 and older in the United States, then our population there would be all people 65 and older in the US. If our study is interested in virus death rates for all people in the world, then the population for that study would be all people in the world. Of course, when we're studying these populations, we typically can't survey or look at every single person in our entire population. So what we do is we take a sample of that population. Again, if we're studying heart disease in people 65 years of age and older in the US, then our sample there might be 100 randomly selected citizens from across the US. If our study is about virus death rates all across the world, then maybe what we would do is take a small sample from each country, but that might not be the best way to collect the sample for this study. Thinking about different ways that you could collect the sample for this study leads to a discussion about a few techniques for sampling. Let's take a look. Our first technique is just going to be random sampling, sometimes called simple random sampling. In a random sample, or a simple random sample, each item in the population has an equal chance of being selected. An example of this would just be putting 10 names into a hat and randomly drawing a name. Or let's say you have a list of 1,000 students and you want to randomly draw 10 students. What you might do is order those students, give every student a number, and then use a random number generator to choose 10 students. Our next sampling technique is called systematic sampling. With systematic sampling, what we do is we choose a random starting point and we select every nth item for our sample. For example, if you wanted to survey grocery store customers, maybe you would survey every 50th customer that walks into the door. The next sampling technique is called convenient sampling, and that's just what it sounds like. We're using readily available data to create our sample. For example, I might have a survey that I want to conduct, and maybe I just put that survey online somewhere, and whoever sees this and wants to answer the survey can do so. Basically, anytime you're using the most convenient method to create a sample, that would be convenient sampling. Our last two sampling techniques are pretty easily confused. One is called cluster sampling. And in a cluster sample, we divide our population into units, which is often done geographically. And then we take a random sample from each one of those units, or we use one entire unit as our sample. An example here would be selecting, say, 10 people from each county in a state to collect polling data. A non-geographical example would be from all the boxes of screws that a manufacturer makes, select one box and test every single screw in that box for defects. That would be considered to be a cluster sample. Our last sampling technique is called stratified sampling. And in stratified sampling, we divide our population into classes, also called strata, that are already there. For example, we could divide a population up by age, or gender, or race, or religion, or income, or something like that. And then from each one of those classes, we can collect a random sample. An example here would be dividing up, say, the population of the US into 5 age groups, and then collecting virus data from each of those 5 age groups. The next set of problems in this section involves the misuse of statistics. Basically, you're going to be given a bunch of statements that aren't valid, and you have to say why they're not valid. For example, you might read a statement that says that more men than women are involved in automobile accidents. We'll take that as a fact, but then this statement says that therefore women are better drivers than men. While the conclusion may or may not be true, we can't base the conclusion that women are better drivers than men on the fact that more men than women are involved in automobile accidents. We have to come up with some reasons why. One possible reason is that maybe men drive more miles than women do, and that's why they're involved in more automobile accidents. You might also be able to argue that it's possible that men drive in worse conditions than women, maybe in rain and snow or at night or something like that. Another statement is that after being given vinegar, patients' flu symptoms improved. Therefore, vinegar cures the flu. I think that we can agree that this is invalid, but why? Well, one argument is that patients' flu symptoms improve on their own. That's kind of how flus work. So maybe the vinegar didn't actually have anything to do with that. To study this more closely, what we would need is an experiment where you have, say, a control group that doesn't get any vinegar, and an experimental group that does get vinegar, but that's a whole other discussion. Basically, with these problems, we have to do our best to use our logic to try to figure out why these original statements shouldn't lead to the conclusion that's stated. For the last group of problems in this section, we look at graphs and how they can be a little bit misleading sometimes. Here's an example. Here's a bar graph whose scale on the y-axis goes from 0 to 14. And you can see that most of the data is clustered somewhere around the 10 range. Looking at this graph this way, it doesn't look like there's a lot of variety in the data values. Notice that if I change the scale on my y-axis from 0 to, say, 30, that makes the variety in the data look even lower. It doesn't look like the values of red, blue, green, and purple have much variety. They all look pretty similar. However, if we zoom way in on this data, say if we just make the y-axis values between 9 and 11, that picture is going to look a little bit different. Okay, besides my graph looking really terrible now, you can see that it appears that the data varies quite a bit. And all I did was changed the scale on my y-axis. We just zoomed way in on this data to make it look like there was a lot of variety in the values. Okay, so keep that in mind for some of the final problems in this section. I hope that this video helped you out, and I will see you in the next one.